Thanks for joining this morning, guys. Again, my name's Chris at GoProposal. And yeah, I really want to talk through how we help people, accountants and bookkeepers very specifically, navigate the minefield that is pricing consistently, actually sort of selling your services as well, whether that's to new clients or even sort of maximizing value and selling services to your current client base. And also minimizing risk. And again, to use exactly the same metaphor, the minefield that is engagement letters and AML, and hopefully how GoProposal can potentially help you to solve those issues as well. So yeah, thanks for joining this morning, guys. And again, if any questions, throw them in the Q&A. I'll either answer them as we go, or we will have time at the end to jump into those. But very first thing that I want to sort of start with today is, I suppose, just a view of the problems that I know a lot of firms, having spoken to accountants, being to accountants every single day, although every day, the problems that a lot of people face and where these sort of things tend to stem from. And to sort of use a real simple visualization here, I think the key thing that we see a lot of the times at the sort of start of the majority of, or not the majority, but start of a lot of accountant-client relationships and throughout those relationships as well, is that the scope of the work that you're providing a lot of the time is outweighing the price that you're actually charging. A lot of people don't really have a system in place for pricing up clients, calculating fees for clients. The scope is, you know, you're providing more work than you're actually charging for. Like I say, that can be true with new clients and at the start of relationships. But then as the relationship progresses, it just gets worse. You know, the scope of the services that you're providing increases and the price doesn't increase in line with it. You start providing more services. Maybe that is, you know, those meetings with clients where you're actually going quite deep into some advisory work or planning, you know, tax planning, those sorts of things. The client just sees it as, you know, it was just a phone conversation. It was just a meeting. Why should they have to pay for that? When in reality, you know, you are going above and beyond the scope of the work that you're charging for. And with that, particularly with those additional services that are being added in, we could also be exposing ourselves to a lot more risk than we're covered for in the terms of our engagement as well. So like I say, that could come from the engagement letter, us not covering the scope of the work they're actually providing to clients in those terms of engagement and in that engagement letter. But it could also be from things through things like our AML processes. You know, maybe we've not done our due diligence, you know, KYC risk assessments, ID checks, whatever it might be, as we're onboarding these new clients and as we're dealing with clients on an ongoing basis, we're not covering ourselves for what we should be, and we're exposing ourselves to a lot more risk than we need to be. And these problems can be down to one of a number of things here. So just to run through these quickly, and please again feel free to jump in the chat if any of these particularly do shout out at you, if maybe all of them shout out at you, or if there's anything else that you think contributes to this problem as well. Firstly, it could be that there is just no defined list of services that you're providing to a client from the get-go. So again, in the engagement letter, it could be maybe just a generic template that you send in to all of your clients that sort of hopefully covers every situation. But ultimately, clients might not even know what they're getting for what they're paying for. We might have no sort of systemized pricing structure, or as we call it, a core pricing matrix. So maybe it's a classic phrase people use, maybe it's a finger in the air approach. You know, when new clients come in, it's just a case of sort of thinking, well, you know, we sort of charge these guys similar, it's a similar business, similar services, so let's call it roughly the same. We're sort of haggling over the fees with certain clients who are maybe a bit more stingy than others, but ultimately we've not got a system in place to ensure that we're pricing all of our clients fairly and consistently. It could be down to the fact that there's bottlenecks in the business. So if you've got if you're part of a wider team, or if you've got a team underneath you, is that team reliant on one person, you know, the owner of the firm or partners to come up with these prices? Or are you reliant on the admin team to produce engagement letters, the compliance team to do the AML, whatever it is? We've got all of these people that are slowing down the process, causing bottlenecks in the business. Things aren't as easy and running as smoothly as they should. Going back to the engagement letters, they could simply be outdated. I know some of the professional bodies are better than others at sort of providing up-to-date templates and communicating those updates. So there could just be a lack of confidence from us in the firm of sort of whether our engagement letter templates that we're even using are useful and up-to-date anyway. Our AML processes can be really cumbersome, sitting in different systems all over the place, quite manual in some cases. Maybe we don't really know what we should be doing when it comes to risk assessments for certain clients, or you know, the sort of ID check that we should be carrying out on certain clients as well. And finally, and I think this is true of a lot of processes, even outside of the sort of onboarding journey, ultimately, everything can just be taking too long. It could be manually pulling together an engagement letter. It could be just getting to that price. Maybe it is waiting for someone to come back from annual leave who can price up a certain service in a certain way. They've just got that pricing in their head. And from the client's point of view as well, I think this is even more true. If it's a new client and they're coming to you to, you know, help them take care of the financials of their business and really drive their business forward, if that onboarding journey and that process is too long and too cumbersome, it's all over the place, there's no structure to it, it can really sort of knock their perception of you, sort of how they see you as a brand, I suppose, and the value that you're going to bring to them. So we want to make it really slick, really professional, and really quick as well. You know, they don't want to be waiting 2 weeks for an engagement letter, and then, you know, having their ID requested 2 weeks after that, and then they don't really know where they're sitting. We want it to be really quick, really smooth, and give them everything that they need and all the confidence they need as quickly as we can. And how GoProposal is going to hopefully help us solve that, just to go back to the sort of overall issue here, you know, we're potentially providing too much work for the fees that we're charging to clients. We're exposing ourselves to a load of risk. What we want to do is give people the tools to be able to minimize that risk right down. Unfortunately, we can't totally remove it, so it is still there somewhat. There's always going to be some sort of risk, but we can hopefully minimize that right down. Bring the price or the fees that we're charging in line with the scope of the work that we're providing to clients, and ultimately let us grow that as well. You know, it's, I think a lot of people, they know that they're undercharging some clients and that they could be making more money. And sometimes the way people try and solve that is by taking on more new clients and taking on more work. Ultimately, what we want to do is solve this problem first and foremost. And then once that problem is solved and we are charging all of our clients, you know, what we should be, we're charging for all of the work that we're doing, that is when we can look to grow the scope of the work we're doing with our existing clients, bring in new clients as well, where we're charging what we should be, and grow our practice as a whole in a really sort of profitable way, where we know that we're being fully compliant, we're minimizing that risk, and again, charging for all of the work that we're actually doing. So where we want to get to with GoProposal ultimately is pretty much the flip side of all the problems that we've seen there. So we want to have a clearly defined scope of work with each and every client. We want every client to know exactly what we're doing for them, what their responsibilities are for each service, what our responsibilities are for each service. And obviously, if any services fall outside that scope of work, we want them to be aware of that so that we can add it to the engagement letter easily and ultimately make sure that we're charging for it as well. We want to have a profitable core pricing matrix where we are, again, charging for all of the work that we're doing. But even if we're providing the same service to different clients, that we're charging fairly and transparently as well for each client based on their business and, you know, how much work we are doing in each case. We want scalable systems where we're removing those bottlenecks from the business, and we're not relying on one person. Anyone in the team can have these conversations. Anyone in the team can carry out these tasks, whether it is producing a proposal, repricing a client, carrying out AML checks, whatever it might be. We want up-to-date, smart engagement letters that adapt to changes in legislation, that are up-to-date and updating for us. They're easy to reissue to clients as well when we need to re-engage clients. We want streamlined AML processes where, again, anyone in the team can confidently do what they need to and do it as quickly as possible. And that's, again, the bottom one there. We want time-saving efficiencies across the board. We want this to be as quick and easy as possible. And we want it to be quick from the client's perspective as well, so that they get the best possible picture of our firm, particularly if it's a new client upfront. They're seeing how good we are at what we do. We want that client journey to be as slick as possible as well. But to give more context to what I'm talking about, I want to jump into GoProposal and walk you through this journey sort of from end to end, really. So predominantly, I want to do that from the point of view of, you know, what does it look like if we've got a new client coming to the business? How are we going to come up with a price for the services that we're providing? How are we going to send them a proposal and an engagement letter? How are we going to get them signed up? And then how are we going to handle the AML responsibilities off the back of that? But the very the first thing that I just wanted to really quickly show is also how GoProposal can help with that core pricing matrix and that very first piece of the puzzle, which can be having, you know, profitable pricing structure in place. Because a lot of the time, I think, and some of you guys might might be this way currently, like I say, there's that finger in the air approach to pricing clients, where it's just a case of, you know, we're going to be doing these services, I think it's going to roughly take this long, I'm going to charge them this much a month, or, you know, whatever that might look like. And converting that in and building something out from that into sort of, you know, a pricing structure or a system that we can use to price up clients can seem quite daunting, and you might not know where to start. But with GoProposal, if you sort of sign up for a trial of GoProposal, one of the very first things, well, literally the first thing you see when you log in will be this screen here, except it'll have your name here rather than the word ignore in capital letters, unless your name is ignore in capital letters. But it will basically guide you through just a few questions about your business, the services, the types of services that you offer, and then a few questions about specific services and sort of what you would potentially charge for these services and these situations. And it will basically take your answers to those questions, which you can answer in any way that you want. You can answer it from an hourly rate perspective, from a finger in the air perspective, any sort of way that you want to tackle it, answer these questions, and it will convert it to a full sort of pricing structure for you, covering, just to go back, a lot of the services that you see here. So bookkeeping services, compliance services, payroll services, advisory services, and it will give you a starting point to start working from. So you could literally run through this. It takes 5 minutes max, I would say. You can run through this, and then you could literally, using that, start sending proposals to clients straight away, repricing clients, running clients through the system to benchmark your fees and what you're currently charging. And even that can be a really worthwhile exercise in itself. So if you potentially were sort of interested in GoProposal, but you had no idea how to get started, I just wanted to point out sort of how easy that is to get to that version one of your pricing. But where you would hopefully be spending most of your time within GoProposal, if you're using GoProposal, is here, the sort of client-facing, as we call it, side of the tool, where you're going to be producing proposals, producing engagement letters, adding clients to the system, and, you know, pricing new clients, repricing existing clients. And the first thing that I always like to sort of point out about the way GoProposal works is it is very much designed to be used in as a client-facing tool. So if you guys were one of my clients now, I could be running through this over Zoom or Teams, whatever it might be, having the conversation, you know, if you were a new client, you know, what are we going to be doing for you? Coming up with a fee on the spot, producing a proposal, an engagement letter on the spot, and ultimately giving you or giving the client everything they need to make a decision before that initial call or initial meeting has finished. So yeah, that could be virtually as we are now. It could be literally, you know, in the room with someone, GoProposal on the iPad, GoProposal on the laptop, up on the big screen, but use it as a tool in those meetings to help you also sort of more confidently sell your services as well. So, you know, being able to run through a full list of your services, your full service offering, upsell potentially other services that you the client might not even have known about previously, but giving them transparency over where their fee is coming from, how their fee is built up, and like I say, giving them everything they need to make a decision there and then. So as we come through, and Ascend is just our fictional accountancy firm, so obviously this is branded up and designed to be used as a tool specifically for your firm. But as we come through, we can select our template for our proposal. So really simple example here, you might have a new client template which has testimonials, more branding, graphics, and meet the team page, for example. you know, more sort of a sales document, then you might have an existing client template, which is really simple to the point. Please see your revised services and your revised fee, as discussed. And you could even have, you know, two new client examples, one for those more maybe corporate clients where you do want a bit of a sales document. And I know a lot of people like a really simple template that is just, here's the services we're providing, here's how much it's going to cost. And that is pretty much it, for those clients who, you know, just don't care about anything but how much they're going to be paying. So we can have those options there. But basically, we select the template at this point, and the system is going to do the rest for us. And it's the same with the letter of engagement. So I've chosen the limited company option in this case, but this is specifically where our OverSuite product comes into play as well. So with GoProposal, the system is going to, you're going to have that pricing built into the system, and you can have the ability to create a proposal, create the engagement letter. And when GoProposal first started, it was a case of still having to manage your own templates and your own, you know, letter of engagement content within the system. So the system would still pull it together for you and automate that process, but the content was still very much managed by the firm, by the accountants, or by the bookkeepers. With OverSuite, that is all taken care of for you. The system will build a full library of engagement letters with, I think it's over 70 service schedules now for different services. It'll be specific to your firm and to your professional body. And the key thing here is that it's all kept up to date. So any changes to even stuff like GDPR, it'll build you a privacy notice that goes into the engagement letter. Any changes to GDPR will be reflected within OverSuite. Things like MTD, if and when it ever actually happens, there's going to be some quite big changes there to sort of the responsibilities and both the accountant and the client side. So again, that will all be updated automatically. And with this as well, we also send out an OverSuite quarterly update. So letting you know of any changes that have been made, so you're in the loop and you know what's going on, but also advising any action you might need to take off the back of that, because a lot of the time, it's just that, you know, next time you do reissuing engagement letter for this client, rest assured, these things have changed, and that's going to be reflected in your engagement letter. But chances are you're not going to need to sort of immediately re-engage all your clients. Again, to use MTD as an example, in that instance, you likely are going to want to re-engage all of your clients because the terms and conditions basically have changed quite dramatically. And so we'll always offer that sort of insight and that guidance as well. So everything always up to date, always up to spec for your professional body, and that sort of inbuilt guidance as well, which is quite handy. But for both the proposal and the letter of engagement, we select the template, and the system is going to do the rest, and we'll see the finished product in just a second. Excuse me. We then get to the services and the pricing element of GoProposal. And this is controlled by things like, so firstly, the annual revenue range that we've got up here, so the annual revenue range for the client, that's going to potentially drive the pricing of certain services, like as an example, annual accounts, VAT returns, management accounts, potentially, we might want to price based initially on the annual revenue of the client. But then as we sort of select services and check services, tick in services in here, we'll be prompted with this sort of service specific variables that we want to factor in when it comes to the price as well. So you'll see we might want to price things like bank reconciliation on number of transactions and frequency, raise and send invoices on the number of invoices. And we find this works really well because, as I was saying before, it's a really sort of transparent view for the client. They can see what their fee is based on, you know, where's the fee coming from, how have you got to that number. But we also find when it's tied to something sort of from the client's business, so to speak, number of transactions, revenue, whatever it might be, it's more sort of relatable for them. They can see, okay, yeah, that I can see where that figure is coming from. But importantly, particularly for the new clients, I think, it's almost an education piece to say that, okay, yes, your fee is going to be based on your revenue, number of transactions, number of invoices, staff, whatever it is. As those numbers go up, if you are doing, you know, if your turnover doubles and you've got, you know, twice as many transactions going through your bank, and we're doing your bookkeeping, and you take on five more staff, and we're doing your payroll, you know, that's what the fee is based on. So the fee is going to go up as well. So rather than getting to the point where, you know, we price up a client using that finger in the air approach to start with, we're potentially already undercharging them from the start. 5 months down the line, we realize that we're losing money because we've never repriced them. rather than get to that point and having to have a really awkward conversation where we say to the client, listen, I need to sort of treble your fee actually, because I've been undercharging you for the last 5 years. We can set out the expectation from the start. And as you know, it might be every 3 months you look at the bookkeeping services, the bookkeeping variables to make sure they're still in the right band. Even just once a year, looking at the service offering in general and what we're doing for them. Are there any additional services that we need to get in there or that we've maybe missed over the previous year? We can have those more regular sort of touch points and checkpoints for the fee, having already told the client that's going to happen at the start. And we don't need to have any of those awkward conversations around the fee because we've set our stall out from the very start and the expectations have been set. The client knows exactly what's going to happen. So not only are we sort of putting ourselves in a really good position with having that fee structure in place, we're also going to limit those awkward conversations that people hate having where the fee is going up. I've spoken to people in the past where they've used GoProposal on a client and it's gone up literally 10 times what they're currently charging them. Obviously, that's a much tougher conversation, and we can still help people sort of navigate those conversations using GoProposal as well. But the more we can limit those conversations, the easier it's going to be for everyone. Just to give a couple more examples, things like the quality of records, you know, if you're doing the bookkeeping, maybe something like the annual accounts, the corporation tax return, that's going to be cheaper as a service because we know that the bookkeeping is going to be done, well, hopefully if we're doing it, we know it's going to be done to a high level. Industry or business type as well, really important in some cases. Maybe you know that construction companies, let's say, you want to charge more because there's more complexities or more work to be done. But again, we can build in whatever we want here, even with the quality of records. You know, we could say, well, if you turn up with a shoebox full of paperwork and expecting us to deal with it, then we're going to charge you a premium for that. And you can get really sort of specific with these as well. You could say that, you know, good is fully reconciled accounts using our preferred software or whatever it might be. Again, excellent might be only if we do the bookkeeping for you. Really sort of set, you know, if you're gonna say you've got excellent records, well, it needs to be this. It's not just you saying that you think you've got excellent records. So again, making sure we set the expectations and we're being really sort of transparent and clear with clients as well. I mentioned payroll briefly, but again, we can make sure that we're specifically charging for the amount of work that's being done there. If it's down to the number of employees, again, frequency maybe, we can factor those things in. And I think I touched on this very briefly before, but being able to lay out, again, all the services that we can actually provide to clients. Their experience with accountants or with bookkeepers might have been terrible in the past because they've had terrible service. Maybe they just think accountants do, you know, year-end accounts and compliance and corporation tax, sorry, that's the extent of their understanding of accounting. Maybe they don't know that you could do their bookkeeping or do management accounts or forecasting or budgeting or whatever all this stuff is, tax planning, whatever it is. If we have this conversation using GoProposal in the meeting and guide them through sort of all the services, we can bring these things into the conversation as well. You know, did you know we could do this for you? Did you know we could do that? Again, we could have different levels within there, you know, levels of complexity or different packages that we offer in each case. And we can even, let's use the bottom one as an example. If a client isn't ready for something or they just want to know a bit more about something, we can include it on what we call the roadmap. It'll be in a separate section in their proposal, letting them know what that service is and how much it would cost if they were to go with it in the future. When something is in there, if we do have that catch up 12 months down the line, we're having quarterly meetings with them, whatever it is, we can say, you know, listen, you know, we talked about some forecasting or some budgeting, some planning work for you. I think it'd be a great time for us to look at that. Let's do that over the next 3 months, see how we get on. It's always just sort of opening up those further conversations and seeing where the added value is that we can be providing to clients as well. But importantly, we're making sure that with these things, where we are adding it to the proposal, obviously we're making sure we're charging for it, but we're also making sure that it's going to be in the engagement letter as well. But as we'll see in a second, we've obviously got our overall template for the engagement letter, which is going to control the sort of main body of the document, but it's just going to pull in the service schedules for the services that we've selected for each client as well. So really clearly defined scope of work, as we were talking about before, making sure that we're covered for the work we're actually providing. And again, obviously making sure that we're always charging for it too. We can also make sure any software we're going to be using, we're including that in the fee where possible, where when we need to, where we're passing on the cost to the client, we can make sure we're doing that. And we'll also see this pull into what we call the apps map in the proposal as well, which we'll see in a second, just a graphical overview of the software we're using and the what it's actually for. Well, you know, some clients might not know what half this stuff is, so nice to give them a quick overview of what it is and what it's for. But then once we get to this point, we can calculate the fee. Like I say, everything's built into the system. The system is going to come up with the fee for us straight away. And obviously at this point, if we are doing this live with a client, we're presenting the fee to them there and then. And there's basically, to put it really simply, there's two outcomes to to sort of the conversation. They could say, that sounds great. You know, what's the next steps? How do we get going? In which case, that's brilliant. We've not got that awkward situation of, okay, well, let me just go away and pull together an engagement letter and speak to the team about getting that over to you and, you know, sending you a proper proposal. And, you know, it takes a week or 2 weeks to actually send them anything. In that meantime, they've cooled off. Maybe they speak to another accountant or another bookkeeper or get talked out of spending so much money by their partner or whatever it is. We can call all of that out. If they say, brilliant, what's next? We can send them the proposal and engagement letter straight away. And if we're with them, we can literally pull up an on-the-spot acceptance for them to sign there and then as well. So if they're happy with everything, brilliant, let's capitalize on it. Let's get them signed up. But that's not always going to happen just because you're using GoProposal, unfortunately. If someone is to say, you know, that's a lot more than I'm paying currently, is there anything you can do about the fee? I was hoping to spend less than a grand a month or whatever it is. We can reframe the conversation from that point of view as well. We can firstly show them exactly where the fee is coming from. If we want to, we can say, listen, you know, this is everything we've talked about. Doing your bookkeeping, we're doing your obviously compliance work, payroll, and we've thrown in some advisory services as well. It's not to say that the fee can't come down, that's absolutely fine, but let's jump back in and let's see how we can bring the fee down. We can't give you any of these things for free. I'm sure you appreciate it. I can't give any of these services away for free, but let's jump back in and see what we can do. So it could be a case of, you know, changing the frequency of a certain service, changing the level of a certain service, taking something else out and putting it on the roadmap. Obviously, it might be a bit of a longer conversation than that, but you hopefully see what I mean. So we can have that conversation, remove those services, change the scope of those services, recalculate the fee, and bring the fee down in a much more sensible way. So in this case, brilliant, you know, brought it down below £1,000 a month, and it might still be more than you're paying currently, but we're still doing some management accounts, we're still doing some budgeting, whatever it is. We bring the fee down, but it makes sense for both the client and us as well. We're still charging for all of the work that we're actually doing, and we're adapting the engagement letter at the same time. So any services we've taken out, they're taken out of the engagement letter. We're keeping just the scope of work that we're dealing with for that client in the engagement letter before we send it. You'll also see we've got our alignment fee. So certain services like year-end accounts, in this case, if we're engaging a client partway through the year, the system will account for any missed monthly fees that we need to pay, need to charge for, in the case of those sort of full year services where we always want to charge for 12 months worth of work. And then at this point, we can just fill in the client's details. We've got both our nominated individual, our sort of you know, main contact at the client, but also the option to add in additional people so we can get multiple signatures from people if we need to. We've heard some horror stories about people not doing that in the past and being pulled into all sorts of arguments between, you know, a couple or, you know, directors who end up having a falling out and they say, oh, I never signed an engagement letter for you to speak to so-and-so about my personal affairs or my affairs in the business or whatever it might be. So we can get authorization, remember what we need up front. And we can also trigger off the relevant AML checks where we need to as well. So again, if there's multiple people where we need to be carrying out ID checks or, you know, risk assessments, KYC assessments, we can trigger all of those as well. We've got our internal details. So as I said before, we want the ability for anyone in the team to be able to have these conversations with clients or send proposals, you know, whether it's new clients or existing clients, so everyone can track their own proposals and track their own clients in the system too. We can also agree follow-up dates, include what we call a future goal quote. So this could be sort of anything really, but I think something to just add a bit more of an extra layer to the conversation rather than it just being, okay, we're going to do, you know, I'm your accountant, you're going to pay me this much, see you in 12 months. It's going to be, okay, yes, but we're help. What, you know, what do you want to achieve here? Is it you want to free yourself up from, you know, the bookkeeping to do X, Y, and Z. You want to, you know, grow the turnover so you by 10% in the next year, and so you need some, you know, forecasting and some planning work to help you get there. It could be something as simple as they want to stop working. Just put an example in, stop working 7 days a week, spend more time with their family, or something like that, and we want to do that by the end of this year. So we can build that in, include it in the proposal again, add that extra layer to the conversation. And similar to the roadmap that we're talking about and that we'll see in the proposal in a second, something we can always be referring back to, you know, with the roadmap, it can be, we talked about doing some management accounts for you. Let's look at that. With this, it could be, you know, we wanted to say, we want to stop you working 7 days a week. We're doing your bookkeeping. We're doing X, Y, and Z for you. Have you managed to do that yet? What's the next goal? We could always be recalibrating that as well. And then finally, we've got our key dates. So for certain services, let's choose a random date here, so that's filled in. For certain services, I'm just going to use annual accounts again as an example. We might want to set out deadlines to the client around when they need to provide us information. So in this case, I've said that any client where I'm providing them with annual accounts and a corporation tax return, they need to give me the information 3 months after their year end for the filing deadline, obviously 9 months after their year end. So based on the services we select for each client and the dates that we put in for each client, it's going to calculate these deadlines for us. It's going to include them in the engagement letter, so we know every single client has all the relevant deadlines that they need to be aware of, and they're signing off on those deadlines as well. So again, similar to the fee conversation, how we know we're not going to have everyone saying yes just because we're using GoProposal. We're unfortunately probably not going to have everyone hitting these deadlines just because we're using GoProposal, but it's nice to know that everyone has had all of the information that they need when it comes to deadlines, and they've signed off and agreed to it. And it's even going to prompt us to tell them at this point as well if we are running through this with them. But then once we get to this point, we've got both the proposal and letter of engagement good to go. And let me just make sure that these both load before I start. So brilliant. With the proposal, as I said, we've got graphics, testimonials, branding, whatever we want. We can include it here. We have templates for all sorts of different types of clients, types of service, different situations. As I say, we can include testimonials. We can include full page A4 graphics. And these could be whatever you want them to be. You can just drop them into the template. All of the actual content here, obviously my introduction is a bit boring. You might want to actually say more about your firm and why they should be working with you, you know, particularly if it is for a new client. We got a full breakdown of the fees, similar to what we saw above, so the client can see exactly what they're paying for each service. We've got that future goal quote pulling in, if we choose to include that too. And we're also letting the client know what's going to happen next. Again, this is sort of template specific, so different clients, different services, this might be different. But I think this is something where a lot of people actually let themselves down a little bit because, yeah, that really sort of smooth process, but then the client signs up and they have no idea what's going to happen next. So is it going to be that they need to send their ID, or they're going to be sent up the payments in a certain way, or you're going to be doing something in the background that they need to be aware of? Just giving them confidence in what's going to happen after they sign up. Another full page graphic, so meet the team page as an example. Joe didn't include me on our made up one, but no hard feelings. And then we've got the apps map that I very briefly mentioned. So just based on the software we select for each client, it will populate this, letting the client know what that software actually does and how it sort of fits into the flow of the business as well. Just a nice, simple overview of how that's going to work. And then we've got a full breakdown of the services we've selected. We have a little description for each service as well, a really nice way to sort of communicate the value of each service. I think particularly with just bookkeeping as an example, because it's on the screen, a lot of clients I know can sort of say, oh, I'll just do my own bookkeeping. You know, they see the adverts for things that make it look like it's just sort of tapping a button on an app these days, and that everything's sort of done and amazingly well prepared. We know that's not the case. So really sort of just communicating the value of each of these individual services and what we're going to be doing. But importantly, we've got the scope of the work in there as well. So the client can see obviously what they're paying for each service. They can see that in the fees. But here they can see what they're getting in return for that fee as well. So again, if their revenue goes up, transaction numbers go up, more staff on the payroll, whatever it might be, frequency changes for certain services, it's just really easy for them to see why the fee might go up as well. So we've just got real control over that because the clients, like I said, we've set those expectations, we've educated the client on what's going to happen, and we remove the sort of friction from those fee conversations in the future. If I just jump down to the roadmap, we'll see that's very similar, but we're also letting the client know what it would cost if they were to go this fee, this service in the future. So yeah, just really, again, kickstarting those future conversations. Listen, we talked about some forecasting for you last time. Let's start with a simple cash flow forecast just to open up some conversations around what we can do over the next 3 months or 12 months, whatever it's going to be. Just kickstarting those sort of upsell conversations for future meetings. We've got a final testimonial and a final full page graphic. And again, you can keep these templates really simple if you want to. You don't need testimonials, graphics, all that sort of stuff. And you can really cut it back if you want to as well. And then with the letter of engagement, a bit less flashy in terms of the graphics and things like that, but just as important, if not more important, because obviously this is the scope of the work, the terms and conditions, all that sort of stuff. We want to make sure this is up to date, it's correct, and that it's bespoke and specific for each client as well. So based on the template, like I say, that we selected at the start, we've got our introduction and overall scope of work, which is going to be based predominantly on the entity we're dealing with. So in this case, I chose a limited company. And as I say, OverSuite is going to provide us with a full library of engagement letters for different entities, sole traders, individuals, partnerships, whatever it might be. It's going to build us a full terms and conditions, sort of universal terms and conditions for the business and a privacy notice as well. And it's also going to give us, I think it is over 70 now, service schedules for all sorts of different services and different situations. And based on the services we selected, we're just going to pull those into the engagement letter as well. So a really clearly defined scope of work for each and every client. We'll see the client's details and our internal details are just pulling in here automatically. There's nothing we need to sort of manually drop into this document. It's all done for us. We've got the key dates as well, those deadlines pulling in. And so let's scroll back up to the content and come down to the schedule of services. We've just got those specific service schedules pulling in. So laying out the responsibilities for both parties, but having a really clearly defined scope of work so that if we are adding any services in the future, we need to add it to the engagement letter. Really simple to explain that to the client and really easy to do it in GoProposal as well by jumping in and ticking that service. It's obviously going to pull it into the engagement letter, but also it's going to make sure we're charging for that service as well. So we're really sort of tying everything together across sort of the compliance side of things and the pricing side of things to make it really easy to just keep on top of both at the same time. Obviously, all of this content, as I say, is going to be kept up to date for us by OverSuite. It's just going to do the work for us, update all these templates in the background, advise us when we might need to reissue specific engagement letters for certain clients or certain clients where we're providing certain services. You'll see you can also include internal signatures in here, but then when the client does sign, their signature is applied, the preview watermark gets removed, and you both get sent a signed copy of the engagement letter straight away. At this point, you can send that to the client. So if you're finish the meeting, brilliant, send. By the time you've then wrapped up the conversation, they're going to have it in their inbox and they can sign it and everything's done. But the ball's in their court, basically. We've talked about the fee. We've produced both documents, sent them everything they need. And whether they sign it on the spot or after the fact via the email, by the proposal that they receive, they'll be taken straight to this page. They don't need to create an account. They don't need to log into anything, just straight to this page. Digitally sign. I'm sure you've seen something similar to this before. If you've not seen GoProposal, DocuSign or whatever it is, very similar. They can even upload their own signature if they want to. But like I say, they'll trigger the signed engagement letter. You both get sent a copy, but you'll also be able to always access all of your proposals and all the documents from within here. So poor Pete, in this instance, gets bombarded with proposals and engagement letters every day. But we can track when the email's been sent, received, opened by the client, whose signature we might be waiting for. If there's multiple signatories where we might need to just chase up one person, we can access the documents themselves from within here, duplicate the proposal. If it's a yearly renewal, we're going to duplicate it and add some services in. And we can basically manage all of this from within our proposal dashboard here. You'll see we've also got our contacts tab and our contact hub. And let's jump into that so I don't ruin my previously carefully prepared tabs. We've got based on proposal dashboard for tracking all your proposals and specifically the sort of the fees and the documents. But we've got the contact hub here as well, where let's jump into this one as an example. Actually, sorry, we've got a contact hub where we can track the proposals for each client still, but also the AML side of things. So risk assessments, KYC assessments, and ID checks. You'll see that we can get sort of a snapshot of this up front. So for the proposal, the ID check and the risk assessment, we can see whether they need to be done now, and there's action required, whether they're up to date, whether renewal is coming up. We can track all of these things, obviously filter by these things as well, to keep on top of all our, well, particularly the compliance requirements, but also whether we need to review someone's fee on the proposal side as well. But if we come in to one of the contact records, you'll see that we've got, firstly, that overview of the sort of fees and the proposals. We can jump to any of the proposals from here. If we've been working with them for a number of years, we can see how their fee has progressed over time as well. We can see all the individuals that are related to this organization. But if we jump into the AML tab, this is where we can start to manage the electronic checks, the ID checks, and then the KYC and risk assessments as well. So we'll see here, obviously I'm in the organization record, but it's going to show me the ID checks that I need to do for the individuals attached to that company. And from here, I can launch any of these checks. So you'll see there's sort of three different levels. We've got a basic check, the document check, and the full biometric check. So difference being the basic check is sort of the name, address, really sort of basic check to make sure that that person exists, basically. The document check, which will check their ID. So that would then also be based on the passport as an example. And you can run that or the client can do it themselves. And then we've got the full biometric check, which only the client can do. So it's going to, you may have seen this if you've opened a bank account or applied for a mortgage or any of those things where you have to do the little awkward video of your own face or take a photo of yourself and then you scan your passport and it compares the two and makes sure that basically, yes, that ID exists, but it's also in the possession of the person who is the person that the ID says they are. So the sort of full-scale ID check there. And just to give an example of the sort of report that you get from the biometric check, it's done through our third-party partner, Third Fort. So with this one, they would do their, scan their face and then also scan their passport. It would compare the two, send you a full report, full sort of ID check summary, sort of with all the information that you need. So obviously that's the full-fledged biometric check. But then we do have those simpler options as well. On top of the ID checks, we've also got the KYC and risk assessments. And I think this is something from, again, speaking to accountants and bookkeepers, this is something where there's always a lot of confusion around what actually needs to be done or the what actually needs to be completed for certain types of clients. And what we've tried to do with this is really sort of build a process that guides you through what you need to do, rather than it being a case of just, here's all the things you might need to know about any possible client. It's up to you to work out which ones are relevant to your individual clients. So what I mean by that is, if I jump into one that I was already sort of halfway through, if I go to launch an assessment for a client, it's going to ask me whether it's a KYC or a risk assessment. This one, as an example, I've already started for a limited company. So basically, I've chosen it's a, I already forgot which one it was now, risk assessment for a limited company. So for starters, it's just going to take me through what I need to go through for a risk assessment specifically for a limited company. But also, it's got conditional logic built into the system. So dependent on your answer to some of the initial questions, it'll remove any questions that aren't relevant, just guide you through the remaining questions that are relevant and specific to that client. And on top of that, dependent on how you answer certain questions, to use this one as an example, it will flag whether that means that there's potentially an enhanced risk for that client. So in this case, it's telling me that, I don't know what question I'm on, a payment should be received from an unknown or unassociated third party. I've said yes, and it's going to specifically say, well, you might decide to maybe design an ongoing test, or look into those specific transactions to make sure they're all valid. It's going to offer that sort of guidance around any commentary mitigation that you you need to provide around that specific issue. Really, and I suppose similar to OverSuite in the way that we offer the guidance there and sort of have the expertise built into the system, we try to do the same thing here, where even if you don't have a compliance team or you don't have someone with a background in compliance, it's built into the system to sort of guide you through. And again, anyone should be able to go through this and do this for a client. So again, you're not reliant on individual people to carry out these processes for clients. We can get everything done as quickly as possible. But as I say, once those are completed, we can obviously access it within the client's record, but we can also get a snapshot of any that are, which ones do we need to renew soon? Which ones are coming up for renewal? We can get a real sort of snapshot of that across proposals, ID checks, and risk assessments as well. So that is a very sort of whistle-stop tour of GoProposal itself. And just to sort of come back to this slide here, hopefully you sort of see how all of these things sort of slot into that at some point along the process. So the clearly defined scope of work, see, specifically from OverSuite, it's going to provide us with that. But that can be both when engaging new clients, when repricing existing clients, making sure that we're always covering ourselves in the engagement letter. Again, that sort of core pricing matrix, not just for new clients, new and existing clients, setting that expectation, educating the client up front, and then being able to really easily recalibrate fees where needed without any awkward conversations or friction with the clients as well, because they know exactly what to expect. Scalable systems, anyone can do this. You saw me sort of build the proposal. It's just a case of ticking boxes, selecting drop downs, having that conversation with the client, filling in the client's details, really straightforward. And we've had people who use GoProposal where, yes, okay, it's still the client managers or the more sort of sales-minded members of the team that go out and speak to the new clients. But if it's just looking at bookkeeping numbers, recalibrating the fee based on transactions, anyone can go in. We've had people where it's the admin team just go in once a quarter, recalibrate the fee, choose a different template, which is for mid-year fee reviews. They do that, they send it to the client, maybe they give them a quick call or send them an email or something saying, just so you know, based on your initial conversation with so-and-so, I've just sent you your revised proposal. Anyone in the team can do that. OverSuite's going to give us the up-to-date smart engagement letters as well. We've got that really simple guided AML process with everything in one place, everything under one roof, with both the proposal and the compliance side of things. And hopefully you can see how that would save quite a lot of time as well. I know obviously I wasn't having the meeting with the client there, but I've sort of run through everything from calculating a fee, producing a proposal and engagement letter, going through what it looks like to sign it, and then sort of the AML flow from that in about 20 minutes or something, maybe a bit longer. You could do the proposal side can be done within, an hour long client meeting. The AML can, I don't know how long that takes you guys currently in terms of producing the engagement letter and then going through the AML processes. It'd be interesting to sort of compare, because I know it can be anywhere from, a few hours to a couple of weeks. But hopefully you can see that hopefully wouldn't take you a couple of weeks to run through. So saving so much time sort of across that whole journey. But as I said a couple of times already, saving time from the client's perspective as well. They don't want to be sat around waiting for things. They want to just get up and running, see that you've got your own ducks in a row, so you can help them with what they need in their businesses as well. So really just making the process so slick and so quick and easy from the client's perspective as well. And I think one thing that I sort of like to finish on is how this can sort of fit into the wider client experience as well. So just as a bit of an example of how this can be sort of a more cyclical journey rather than just thinking about onboarding new clients and that sort of being the end of the journey, it can be a case of let's start with a new client. Yes, we have that initial client meeting, we use GoProposal to produce a proposal, price, make sure everything's priced consistently, go through those AML obligations, get everything that we need done to onboard the client. But you know, what's happening after that? Is it, you know, the software that I touched on previously? You know, are we providing software to drive efficiencies in the client's business, ensure they have the best digital records? Are we taking care of that piece? Is that something that's part of our sort of client journey anyway? And then are we sort of offering those higher levels of advisory services where we can sort of grow the revenue from each individual client that we're dealing with? Or are they just staying on the same fee and the same service sort of throughout? We never revisit that. And then if we are providing those sort of advisory services, whether it's, you know, forecasting, tax planning, whatever it might be, we can then use those meetings to take us back to the first cycle here, where brilliant, you know, we're having a quarterly planning meeting, a quarterly forecasting meeting. You know, let's just open your proposal again. Was there anything else we talked about last time? Or, you know, we said we might do some budgeting for you as well. Should we get that in there? It could be that, you know, you've got a new director, some AML stuff we need to take care of there. So we'll just send them some, and we need to do a biometric check. So we'll send that over. Whilst I'm doing that, I've just noticed actually revenue's gone up a bit. We've got, you know, more staff on the payroll. We need to add the director to the payroll. All these things can tie in together. So rather than it being sort of distinct pieces of the journey, we can roll it all together. If we're dealing with AML, we can take care of the fee, upsell additional services. If we're talking about advisory stuff or whatever it is, we can bring in the fee conversation, make sure we're reviewing the engagement there where we need to as well. So I think, yeah, it's really like to encourage thinking of this as an ongoing cycle rather than an onboarding journey with an end point, because I think we can always bring these things, tie them together to make sure we're providing as much value as we can to all of our clients, but also make sure that we're ultimately charging for all of the work, all the work that we're doing as well. So that is pretty much everything, I think, from me, guys. One thing that I will do is I'll just drop in in the chat, the link to our website, which will take you to sign up for a free trial. So there's a full 30-day free trial of GoProposal, OverSuite, and the AML piece. You can trial it all. Like I say, first thing it will ask you on there is, it won't ask you, but it'll run you through the pricing wizard. So even if you just wanted to spend 10 minutes, sign up for a trial, running through that pricing wizard, it will give you, as we call it, a core pricing matrix specific to you, the services you provide, and specific to your answer to those questions. So specific pricing for you. You can even just download that as a PDF, go away, build it into a spreadsheet if you wanted to, and use it in your own software if you use something else, or if you just wanted to use it from a spreadsheet, you'd be able to do that. But obviously you'd also have time to actually send some proposals to clients. If you've got a new client meeting coming up, give GoProposal a try. If you've got some clients where you know you're undercharging, whack them through, see how the fee comes out. Maybe there's an opportunity there to book those guys in for a conversation, a meeting, and get them onto a more profitable fee. But yeah, the link's there. If anyone does want to jump on a free trial and explore that, feel free to also, sorry, one thing I also forgot to do is put my email address in there. Feel free to reach out to me directly. If there are any questions, I can't see any in the Q&A. So I'm hoping I just did an amazing job of explaining everything. So there's just no possible questions to even ask. But yeah, if anyone wants to ask anything afterwards, if you jump on the trial and something doesn't make sense and you ask a question, feel free to reach out to me. But if you do sign up for a trial, one of the team will be in touch. It might be me anyway, just to make sure you get everything you need. Even book on like a one-to-one demo to really talk about your specific challenges, how we might be able to help solve those with GoProposal. But yeah, if you want to reach out to me in the meantime, then please feel free. But yeah, I can't see any questions, like I say, in the Q&A. So I will let everyone go and crack on with their, I thought it was Tuesday, but it was a bank holiday, wasn't it? So it's Wednesday. Let everyone crack on with their Wednesday. But yeah, thanks a lot, guys. Thanks for joining. I hope you found that useful. I hope you found it insightful, and hopefully speak to some of you soon if you do decide to give GoProposal a shot. So yeah, thanks a lot, guys. Thanks for joining, and cheers Jackie, thanks for joining, and yeah, hopefully speak to one or two of you again soon. Thanks everyone.